So ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. Thank you for making your way promptly back for the start of this next session, which will be looking at the transparency privacy conundrum. It's my pleasure to introduce your chairman for this session, Tom Simpson, who is a lecturer in philosophy and public policy here at the Blavatnik School of Government. And I'll allow Tom to introduce the panel and our speakers. Tom.
Great, thank you very much, Callum, and it's a real pleasure to open our penultimate session for the conference. And just to show the connectedness of the Blavatnik School, the organiser, Alison, put a special request in to Apple, Microsoft, Google, Twitter and Facebook to write an open letter to President Obama, which indeed they did yesterday, to confirm the timeliness and the importance of this topic. So it feels a bit like, through the course of the conference, technology and particularly the internet has been a running theme, even without being explicitly addressed in detail. And what we're trying to do is redress that and really go into some depth about some of the moral and political issues raised by contemporary technologies. So it's a real pleasure to welcome Professor John Naughton, who's come over to join us from Cambridge, who's the Emeritus Professor for the Public Understanding of Technology at the Open University and the Vice President of Wilson College, and has also written for The Observer for, I think, 25 years. No, is that right? A very illuminating column. And I'd like to invite him to speak first, and then I'll introduce Lord Macdonald after that. So, John.
Thank you, Tom. Good morning, folks. My colleague David Runciman makes a very useful distinction between scandals and crises. In democracy, scandals happen all the time. And they're very intense for a while, and then they kind of go away, and nothing much changes. Crises are different. They are explosions of controversy which turn out to be about something really serious and lead to structural change in one way or another. Now, my current preoccupation, as in common with many other people, is the implications of what we have been learning since last June about the way in which comprehensive surveillance of the internet has evolved to its present level. And the question for me is this a scandal or is it a crisis? Now, if you think back to an earlier case that we had in this country, which was the explosion of controversy about phone hacking and the conduct and culture of our mass media, and especially our popular newspapers. Initially, I genuinely thought this was a crisis. I thought this is something that will lead to fundamental change. My suspicion now is that it was just a scandal, because I don't think in the long run there's going to be serious change. Despite all the talk about it, despite all the loud declarations of outrage and so on from our establishment and our politicians and so on, in the end, not much, my hunch is that not much will change. Partly because the reason we have such bad behavior in British mass media is because the British public rewards it by buying the newspapers which engage in bad behavior. And if you reward behavior, then in general you reinforce it. So, now, the question about the Snowden and NSA stuff and the other things we have discovered, is this a genuine crisis? And my hope is that it is. But I wouldn't bet on it just yet. If it is a genuine crisis, then we will have major change in due course. And that will be the test. A couple of words about Edward Snowden, the whistleblower at the heart of this, because he's a very controversial figure. And people have a whole spectrum of opinions about him, from that many people view him as a hero, many people view him as a criminal. Some people in the US Congress say unprintable things about him, and so on. Whatever you think about him, I think one thing you now have to concede, and I've been tracking what he's been releasing since June the 6th. He's a very astute guy. And he's astute because, unlike, say, poor old Bradley Manning, he didn't just hoover stuff from using the privileged access to networks that he had. And the extent of those privileged access of that privileged access, by the way, is an interesting question for people in government, how the Americans could allow that level of access to so many people, most of whom are not working for the government directly, is beyond me. But anyway, never mind. The point about Snowden is that he appears to have worked in a very systematic way. You know, that he identified early on a set of activities within the NSA, conducted by the NSA, which he thought were representative or examples of, as it were, organizational overreach, or perhaps unethical behavior, or illegal behavior in the sense of contrary to the Constitution of the United States. And in each of those, for each of those cases, for each of those examples of organizational misbehavior, he identified documents and other sources and other kinds of evidence that might be useful in sustaining a case around that each particular one. So he has been very systematic, and one of the reasons why the revelations have been so interesting and so important is because they really do shed light on aspects of this that we didn't know before. Now, where does this fit in with government? I think, actually, in a way, the issue when you get down to it is very simple. Democracies always face a dilemma in areas like this, because on the one hand, democracy requires, in the end, openness and accountability. Because in order for people to give their consent to what is being done in their names, they have to know what has been done in their names. On the other hand, democracies legitimately have to engage in secret activities for a variety of good reasons. And the problem there is that publicity about one's necessary but secret activities undermines their effectiveness, or may undermine their effectiveness. So in a way, democracies always face a choice. The choice, in the end, comes down to this. Do we sacrifice accountability, or do we sacrifice some of the secret things we do? And it's not a clear-cut choice, even though you can state it simply, because sometimes there are good reasons, there may be good reasons for sacrificing accountability. For example, during the Cuban Missile Crisis in the 60s, the way in which Jack Kennedy resolved the crisis was by secretly offering to withdraw United States missiles held in Turkey, in other words, about the same flying distance from Moscow as Havana is, in return for the Cuban, for the Soviet Union withdrawing its missiles from Cuba. But if Kennedy had told the American public at the time that that's what he was proposing to do, he might have been overwhelmed by hostile public reaction. So there's a case where sacrificing accountability may have been a good thing to do. And there are probably lots of other cases where that's true too. On the other hand, the other choice is sacrificing the policy, the secret activity of some kind. And there, a decision rule that I suggest is a good one, is that if the policy needs to be secret, or the activities need to be secret, because if the public knew about them, then they would not give their consent, then that's usually a pretty good way of a pretty good justification for thinking very hard about whether or not what a government is doing actually should be doing. Now, of course, what happens in our democracies and what has happened is that governments don't like making those kind of very hard choices. So what they have tended to do in this area is to fudge it. In other words, what they have done is they have devised methods for lifting the veil of secrecy just a tiny bit in order to provide a kind of semblance of accountability. And for me, the real importance of the Snowden revelations is the way they have demonstrated how threadbare and duplicitous that semblance actually is in relation to the internet. That's me.
Thank you very much, Sean. And it's a great pleasure to welcome Ken Macdonald, who's the Warden of Wadham, and also formerly the Director of Public Prosecutions here in the UK. And one of his recent responsibilities was to oversee an internal review of counter-terrorism and security powers in 2010-2011. So the evolution of public regulation has been a matter of personal involvement for you, so Ken, can I invite
Thanks,
you?
Tom. I just wanted to try and start by asking the question where this stuff is coming from. By the stuff, I suppose I mean most sharply Operation Tempura, the GCHQ operation, which essentially scoops up material from the transatlantic cables through which communications data passes. And I think to answer that question, we need to go back to 2006 when John Reid was Home Secretary, and he set up an organization within the Home Office called the Office for Security and Counterterrorism. Traditionally, what had happened was that the security agencies would make their policy submissions to Whitehall, where they'd be evaluated, often sent back as being bonkers or beyond the pale. What John wanted to do was to bring some security service policy making in-house to the Home Office. And he achieved that with the Office for Security and Counterterrorism, which was largely staffed by intelligence agency policy experts, extremely bright young men and women with very clear ideas about where they thought security policy ought to go. And one of their important areas of interest was surveillance. And I think the first major product of the Office for Security and Counterterrorism was the giant database. You may remember the Blairite plan for the government to create a giant database in which all metadata would be held for access by various organs of the state, security services, the police, possibly local councils, and so on. This met with a storm of opposition, much greater than the opposition we've seen to Tempura, actually. People were worried about the security of such a database. They were worried about the Orwellian nature of it. The Labour Party lost the election and the database was shelved. And since both the Liberal Democrats and the Conservatives have strongly opposed it, one might have thought that was that. But instead, we had this year something called the Data Communications Bill, which, while it didn't propose a giant central database, proposed that telecommunications companies should be obliged to hold metadata for a specific period for access by the same organs of state. So on one analysis, a privatized and atomized version of what the Blair government had proposed. This bill was savaged in Parliament by the Public Bill Committee. The Public Bill Committee is a joint committee of parliamentarians, all party group, which examines legislation before Parliament and presents a report to parliamentarians about the quality, the proportionality of the legislation. They produced a report on this legislation which was as savage as any I've seen. They absolutely slaughtered it. They said it was disproportionate, it was ill thought out, it was ill costed, and the implications of it hadn't been considered. Again, we're told with the intervention of the Deputy Prime Minister, the bill was shelved. What we didn't know at that time, what the National Security Committee didn't know, what the Cabinet didn't know, and what the Public Bill Committee certainly didn't know, was that GCHQ were already doing more than the government was asking Parliament to legislate for. And by that I mean they were doing Operation Tempura. Now, the chair of the Public Bill Committee, a Conservative politician, David McLean, now Lord Bencarthor, not a man given to extreme expression, virtually exploded in an interview with The Guardian when he was told about this. Obviously, public bill committees deserve to be treated by the government with respect. This one seems to have been treated with complete contempt, although it may not be fair to say the government, because it seems the vast majority of people in government had no idea about Operation Tempura. So on one analysis, what the security establishment was achieving was the implementation of a technology and a policy within GCHQ in the face of the government having signally failed on two occasions to persuade Parliament or the public that such a policy, such a technology was desirable. And I think that raises all sorts of questions about the governance of these issues. In a recent issue of the London Review of Books, the retired Court of Appeal judge, an extremely brilliant judge, Sir Stephen Sedley, described what he called, quote, a statutory surveillance scheme, shrouded in secrecy, part of a growing constitutional model that raises the question as to whether the tripartite separation of powers, conventionally derived, of course, from Locke, Montesquieu, and Madison, legislature, judicial, and executive, still holds good. And he identified a situation in which, in many democracies, the security apparatus is able to exercise a measure of power over the other limbs of state that approaches autonomy. In this sense, it can procure legislation almost at will. Getting it through Parliament, of course, is another matter. It dominates executive decision making in its own sphere of influence, and it even seeks, through the recent Justice and Security Bill, to lock its antagonists out of the judicial processes. It seems to me that this is a situation which is crying out for greater scrutiny, and I think as a very basic first step, what we need is a Parliamentary Intelligence and Security Committee, which is a proper select committee of Parliament with the powers that select committees have to summon witnesses, to obtain evidence, to write their own reports, and to have its membership and chair selected by both Houses of Parliament. Now, we moved in the recent Justice and Security Bill part of the way down this road, but not the whole way. And I think if there's one lesson of tempora, it's that we need to go the whole way. Our legislation, the Regulation of Investigatory Powers Act, it is designed for a time when people were still bugging mains, British Telecom, or as it then was, GPO, mains boxes with little devices. Although it was an act that was written in 2000, it didn't in any sense anticipate the internet as it exists today. And the most deeply unconvincing attempts have been made by GCHQ lawyers to suggest that an obscure section of that, Section 8.4, governs tempora. It seems to me that that's pretty desperate stuff. And as I argued in a piece in The Guardian a couple of weeks ago, in this area, we need the law to be the master of the technology and not the other way around. At the moment, we have a law that's inadequate, a security agency policy that is rampant, and a parliament that's not being consulted. I'm afraid I'm almost as pessimistic as John is, having set out my stall. I'm not sure that any of this is going to happen. I think someone made a very astute comment, actually, in the last couple of weeks, when he, I can't remember who it was, but he was being asked why it was there wasn't more outrage in the United Kingdom about tempora. And he said, what you have to understand about the Brits is they're not like the Germans or the French. They think that their security services are the good guys. So we haven't had this experience. And by and large, they are. I've worked very closely with them for 5 years. Overwhelmingly, they are. But we've never had a Stasi or a Gestapo or any of those other deeply oppressive organs of security in our country. And I think that conditions the public response. We need to have time for a discussion, so I'm going to stop there.
Great. Thank you very much. Can I just sort of pose a couple more questions just to bring some other stuff out, and then we'll go, we'll open it up. So if I can be slightly provocative, so I was formerly a soldier, so the, as it were, the mentality of the security apparatus is something I know from the inside. And I wonder if the language of domination that was in the book review, Ken, is the right one. So I wonder if it's more seduction is what happens.
Well, it's certainly true that politicians, particularly senior politicians, become very excited when they meet spies. There's no doubt about that. When I was DPP, there was always a mad scramble by people to get themselves invited to meetings of COBRA. COBRA is this wonderful emergency group of senior government and security officials that meets whenever there's a crisis. It met over the floods, and it meets over everything, as far as I can see. It's named after Cabinet Office Briefing Room A, which is the room where it meets. But politicians find this sort of stuff very, very seductive because it makes them feel powerful. It takes a tough politician. If you're being eyeballed by the head of SIS or MI5, and he says, or she says to you, Prime Minister, if you don't give me this power, I can't guarantee public safety. It takes a pretty tough politician like Dennis Healy or one of the old war horses to tell them to get lost. And the new breed of politicians don't do that. I mean, Tony Blair never did it once. I mean, I used to see him in rooms with the security service people. He basically took the view that if they are the experts, if they want something, they must have it. And that's a common view amongst politicians. So I think you're right. You don't have to ask terribly hard. I don't think these security services are storming around Whitehall forcing people to do things they don't want to do. I think we've got ourselves into a situation where, by and large, the convention is that they should be allowed to have the powers they need because they know what powers they need. That's quite a dangerous situation, I think, because it implies a serious lack of parliamentary scrutiny, although in the more recent cases, parliamentary scrutiny has not been too bad.
And maybe, John, just quickly, can you say something about what's so bad about hoovering up vast amounts of metadata? If it's just machines that are looking at it, and it's only human eyeballs that look at it when there's reason for suspicion.
I, I debated this with Malcolm Rifkind, who is the chairman of the Intelligence Service Committee. He was a foreign secretary to whom GCSQ reports, that report, I think. Yeah, okay, I debated that issue with Malcolm Rifkind, who was the former foreign secretary. What struck me, when the Snowden story first broke, one of the things that really struck me as an engineer was two statements, one made by the British Foreign Secretary, William Hague, and the other made by the American president. And the tone, the tenor of both, the paraphrase of both of these remarks was, calm down, folks, don't worry. We're not reading your emails. We are just collecting some metadata, okay? And I remember thinking, watching William Hague say that, thinking, what is this guy smoking? Because content is a pain in the ass. You have to employ people to read it. You have to interpret it. What you want is the metadata. That's what you want. And the reason for that is that in a heavily digitized world, which we now have, metadata is everything, but everything. I could construct from the metadata of anybody in this room, by which I mean the logs of their mobile phone calls, the GPS locations of their phones, and the headers on their emails and other things, I could reconstruct a really accurate picture, a very intimate picture of their lives. End of story. And not only that, but we always have had, ever since Reaper in 1999-2000, we have had unrestricted access to everybody's clickstream. In other words, everything you have read on the net in terms of its URL is logged. And it's logged without a warrant, and it's held. Now, just think about that for a minute, because most of you, I don't know how many people in this room still read physical newspapers, say. But most people, I guess, are going to read newspapers on the net. Okay. Well, every single thing you've read, that clickstream, is freely available. And the great thing about metadata and clickstream data is that it's all machine readable. You can apply machine learning algorithms to it, you can apply pattern recognition algorithms to it, you can do all kinds of stuff with it. And you don't have all this hassle about reading content. So the metadata is the really important bit. And the reason there has been, as far as I can understand, the reason why there has been so little aggro about metadata is because there is, a legal convention which dates back from the analog days, which is that metadata don't belong to you. Your metadata don't belong to you. They belong to whoever provides your communication service. And that comes back from the old days when the metadata, which was the call logs of an analog phone, did belong to the... Ken knows more about this stuff than I do, so I don't... But the point is that somewhere along the line, metadata became easy to get and in a non-regulated way. And what people have not really yet caught up on is the fact that the metadata is the really important stuff.
I think that it's important to understand... The critical paradigm shift which has taken place. Nobody is arguing for one moment, least of all me, that we shouldn't be able to deploy evidence of communications use in criminal trials and in intelligence gathering. Of course, we in serious criminal trials now, we almost always use the sort of metadata that John's talking about. I mean, I once had a client who was accused of murder, and he was accused of shooting someone in the street in Hackney in the middle of the day. And it was possible for the prosecution to track him from where he lived up in Enfield all the way down to the scene of the shooting and then all the way back again because he was using his mobile, and it was some of the most compelling evidence against him. So this stuff is critical and it's important. The paradigm shift is that what has happened is it's now not simply the metadata of people who are suspected of crime or suspected of some sort of misconduct which is being examined. The problem is that everything is being retained for examination. That's a shift. There's a guy called Sir David Omond, who was head of GCHQ and then security and intelligence coordinator in Whitehall when I was DPP, who wrote a paper for the IPPR in 2008, arguing for this very state of affairs. He said the security services should be allowed to access everything and data mine it, even innocent material. They should be allowed to access it to look for patterns of conduct that lead on to items of interest. And the general reaction when he suggested this was that this makes everybody, in one sense, a suspect. And if you start to target the communications of people who are not suspected of crime, as well as the communications of people who are, simply so that you can data mine, then you're going to create a shift in the relationship between citizen and state in fundamental ways, and particularly a shift in the way that people think about the security services. While he argued for that, and while his public position in that respect seemed so controversial, we now know that GCHQ were developing technologies to do precisely the same thing. So essentially what they do is they gather up all of the data from the transatlantic cables. They buffer it for a period of time so that they can data mine it. And I think this is there's a deep philosophical shift here between the notion of the state targeting people whom it suspects of crime and looking at their metadata, and the state saying we can look at everybody's just in case we come up with something. I think that's a philosophical shift that hasn't been debated and which has been done without any scrutiny. And I think that's what Stephen Sedley was getting at in his piece in the London Review of Books. That's it. That is autonomy. That's autonomy on the part of the agencies that are doing it. And that is, I think, an abuse of what Locke and Montesquieu and Madison were talking about.
Thank you very much. Shall we go to questions? Who would like to ask or comment on anything? Corinne, would you like to?
I think the most surprising thing to me since PRISM broke was that people don't seem to care very much about privacy. So there are a bunch of us, people who are working on internet law or policy who have been talking quite a lot about it, but there isn't a larger outcry. So we find now that not only do you have, within the US, for instance, you know, there has been some noise, but have the number of people on Facebook reduced? Not really, right? The sort of long arm, not jurisdiction, but the sort of surveilling of other states and leaders of other states by the US, that hasn't created as much of an outcry as it could. In India, we've got something called the Central Monitoring System, and there isn't even the kind of FISA protection, the sort of very weak, very thin FISA protection there is in the US. So I kind of wonder whether the challenge now is to communicate the dangers and to communicate quite concretely what the problems are. I mean, there was a story in The Guardian recently where the mum was Googling, I think, backpacks.
Yeah.
Do you remember that? And the dad was Googling
pressure cookers.
And the son was looking up the Boston bombings. And the ETS, in all their glory and masks and outfits, you know, broke into their house and, you know, and said, had this sort of bizarre conversation with the dad, and he said, I just wanted to make quinoa. And they said, what's quinoa? You know? my second question to Lord Macdonald is, in a world where technology is moving so fast, and where I'm not quite sure what the algorithms are to narrow down relevant information. But yeah, technology is moving fast and law doesn't move nearly as fast. Is there a way in which one can legislate effectively for this stuff? Because won't security agencies always be ahead?
Let's take another couple of questions in sequence. Yeah, Nicholas.
Hello, my name is Nicolas, I'm from Ecuador. I'm at the Blavatnik School of Government as a student of the MPP. As an Ecuadorian, I had to follow this issue quite closely because of the asylum issues with Julian Assange and with Edward Snowden later on. And it got me thinking about, I wanted to link what you've been talking about to people power politics more closely, because I will be a civil servant and, you know, with any luck, a fairly senior one. And at the same time, you know, as of this year, a defamatory comment on social media about my government can land me 2 years in jail. If a child protests against certain government programs, they've been told by the president that they will have their public education removed. And there is something worrying about having this huge log of everything that I've ever done and everything that everyone's ever done, which can presumably be accessed in some way, you know. How do you see us as future civil servants growing up in a world where everything we've done is logged, is put in this huge metadata, where all of our pictures, a whole metadata of embarrassing pictures of future civil servants, future leaders. How does this all, you know, how do you see us growing up, going into this world, going into government with all sorts of revealing information from throughout our life, really?
And let's take one more, and then we'll go. Mary?
Yeah, I'm sitting wondering about whether this is a generational divide, or this is, and to what extent the argument is that the younger generation are too ignorant about liberty. But let me put to you, what should liberty, that is the freedom of the individual from the state, what should that look like in the 21st century? Because it seems that everyone on the panel sort of takes a 20th century view that there is a powerful, potentially oppressive state which can centralize and control information, and therefore we must stop at doing that. I could argue that in the 21st century, you know, on the one hand, the state is usually overstretched and bumbling, and far from centralizing and controlling information, information is open to everybody, right? So it's supermarkets, it's Google, it's, we should be more worried about Google, in fact, you know, than we should be about governments controlling information. And that the generation that's grown up in there doesn't mind about privacy. You know, they're open with their data, and because it's open to everybody else, we should be less concerned. So I just would like to provoke you to tell us what kind of liberty should people be fighting for in the 21st century? And surely it's a different one than the previous century.
Great, so should we care about privacy? The law is slow, technology moves fast, and is this just a generational change and we're going to learn to live with digital histories available? John, would you like to go first?
Well, thank you for the questions. I'll go in reverse order. We should be more worried about Google, and quotes young people are less worried about privacy. One of the really funny things about this whole discussion for me is the way in which people are always talking knowledgeably about other people and their habits. So the folks of my age are always talking about younger people who don't care about privacy and so on. Well, I'm skeptical of those opinions of older people about younger people, because they're generally wrong and they're based on fantasy. I think, for example, that the widespread meme about how careless young people are about the use of Facebook and the rest of it needs to be revisited, because the young people I know are pretty savvy, pretty smart about it. So that's one thing about it. And I think that's a general kind of, it's a general tenor of a lot of this discussion. So it's not just you and me, it's widespread. Your point about should we be more worried about Google than the state? Well, here's a way of thinking about it. If you want to have an idea of where our networked future lies, then it's on a spectrum. We don't know where we're going. We have no idea where we're headed, really. But if you want to try and say, well, what are the boundaries within the envelope within which we might wind up, then our future is bounded by the nightmares of two English writers, both of them old Etonians, as it happens. One is George Orwell, who thought we would be destroyed by the things we fear. And the other is Aldous Huxley, who thought we'd be destroyed by the things that delight us. Okay? Now, how are we doing? Well, on the Orwellian front, we're doing really well. We're doing even better than we thought, because Edward Snowden has been explaining to us how well the NSA is doing and so on. So we're doing pretty well on that front. On the Huxley front, how many people here have iPhones? Well. Okay, Huxley. Remember, Huxley's Brave New World is about a totalitarian state which keeps its citizens happy with a narcotic called soma and other things, which keep them kind of quiescent. Well, actually, you know, your iPhone is a pretty good example of a Huxleyan device, because you think you own it. You say, it's my iPhone. Well, I got news for you folks, it's Apple's iPhone. There's a thread that runs from your iPhone right across the Atlantic to number one Infinity Loop in Cupertino, which is where Apple is. Nothing happens on that phone that Apple hasn't approved of. Okay? It's Apple's phone, not yours. So that's an example of where, and you're delighted with it. We all love our iPhones, okay? So that's an example of the way in which we have been sleepwalking into this stuff. If you wanted, so my feeling about this is that our societies are sleepwalking into a nightmare. And it's not just a nightmare engineered by an oppressive state. It's a nightmare also engineered by our addiction to free, quote-unquote, services provided by giant companies which have no scruples at all about exploiting our privacy and our identity and other things. Okay, that's where we're sleepwalking into it. And that sort of kind of comes back to your point, which is, why is there so little fuss about it? And I'm baffled by that myself, really baffled. But I think in some ways I attribute it to two things. One of them is a staggering lack of understanding about this technology on the part of both politicians and our institutions. So we are governed by analog mindsets, and we're living in digital realities. That's the first thing. The second thing is actually a failure of imagination. In other words, people have no idea where this stuff could go because they can't imagine it. And from my point, the most interesting thing I've seen in the last three months in this area is nothing to do with Edward Snowden or anything else. It's a novel by Dave Eggers called The Circle. And Dave Eggers is a very good young American novelist. And he's written a book which is actually about a mashup of Facebook and Google. And the book is, the novel takes this innocent girl who gets a job on this great company. And gradually you begin to see where this mindset leads. And what struck me about it was, it takes a novelist to do it. Not an investigative journalist. It's a failure of imagination. We can't see where we're heading, I think. Just as, you know, as one of the NSA older whistleblowers said, we are, in one respect, because we think it's okay because our democratic governments continue the way they are, all the rest of it, we could be, as it were, a keystroke away from totalitarianism at one level because of the database nation that we are building and so on. So, but the overwhelming thing, I think, is this amazing kind of public complacency about it. And I think that's my reason for suspecting that all this Snowden stuff is really a scandal, not a crisis. You know, you have to have real public concern to lead to real serious political change. And I don't see the public concern. Sorry, that's a long answer, but very
helpful. Ken, what are the safeguards on?
Well, I mean, I partly disagree with John about the generational question. I mean, I don't think for one moment that young people, I mean, it's always dangerous to generalise, obviously, but that young people, in inverted commas, don't value privacy in any way. On the other hand, it's perfectly clear that people of a generation of, say, under 40 and certainly under 30 are more used to living fairly intimate aspects of their lives in a public space than people of my age ever were. And I think that is a significant difference. And I think it will make people who live their lives in that way less sensitive to the sort of concerns that other people might have about surveillance, simply because surveillance, if you're on Facebook and you have lots of friends, there is an element of surveillance anyway in your life which you've invited in and you don't see too much of a problem with. So I think there is maybe an element of desensitizing there. And I think that partly answers the question of the chat from Ecuador. You know, President Obama in his first autobiography, in his first book, wrote that he'd used cocaine when he was at college. Who cares? I think we're moving into a world where those sorts of things just don't matter, that people expect that as people are growing up, they're going to behave in certain wild ways, not all of them, but plenty, and it just doesn't matter. So I think that's a good thing to come out of this. Technology and the law. Well, I'd be loath as a lawyer to say that we should give up on this and that technology moves so quickly the law just can't cope with it. I think this is really about scrutiny. This is about having legislation which seems to be up to the minute and seems to be able to cope with the challenges of security policy, but also surveilling security policy to see that it is being adequately controlled by the law. And I don't see these questions of control and these constitutional questions as being a 20th century issue rather than the 21st century issue. I know that proponents of these sorts of policies say that. They say, look, everyone welcomes surveillance, everyone welcomes intrusions into their privacy, and you're talking about the old world. This is a new world when we have to resolve these things differently. But the relationship between citizen and state is going to be an important issue in the 21st century as it is in the 20th century. The question is the balance going to remain where it is at the moment, I think, which is to say we have a relatively, I think, a very benign state in this country, and I think in the United States. I don't think we live in oppressed societies. Some people might disagree. I think the state institutions are benign, relatively speaking. I think the parliamentary surveillance mechanisms are good. The database never happened. The data communications bill didn't happen. But I think that one aspect of our public policy has begun to get out of kilter, and it's partly a reaction to 9/11. It's partly a reaction to all sorts of other things. But I think the security aspect of our public policy is becoming a little out of kilter, and I think the extent to which we are controlling that aspect of policy development and its associated technology development is not good enough. So I think these questions are going to remain, these state-citizen questions are going to remain to be equally vivid in the 21st century. We have to just be careful that we're not slipping into the situation that Stephen described, where we're beginning to see a degree of autonomy and a very important part of the state. So I'm relatively, I think I'm probably a bit more optimistic than John about this. And finally, since we're getting to 12 o'clock and someone mentioned his name, my view about Julian Assange is that he should leave the Ecuadorian embassy, go to Sweden and face his trial.
I haven't agreed with that. Any final burning questions? We'll just take one question. Gentleman in the middle.
Yeah. My name is Al Hassan. I beg to differ when people are concentrating on technology. I think we are seeing a failure of politics and failure of responsible power. If what is happening today in America and Britain, monopolizing everybody's data, metadata, whatever data you want to call it, if that were to be the case for Russia or China or Iran, the media would be out there and lambasting them and saying we are all going to be doomed, all our data is up there, we are not safe. I think there's a false assumption that institutions in US and UK are benign and they don't mean any harm when they have this data. What happens if politics tomorrow change into a fascist regime in UK or America? What happens to the data? The data still sits there. And that's the question. We have to challenge those institutions, whether they are benign or not. They don't have the right to own those data. That's the fundamental thing. So people should not say technology is far advanced ahead of politics or a legislature or policy. It's about power is becoming too concentrated in the hands of some few people, and we have to challenge that, and we have to break it.
John, would you like to just quickly respond?
Yeah, just on that point, I mean, this is a very salutary historical case study, because in the 1930s, one of the better governed and administered states in continental Europe was the Netherlands. And one of the things they had was a really accurate record of the religious affiliations of their population. So they had a database which listed every Jew living in the Netherlands. And that seemed okay because it might have been okay, but the point was it was a liberal regime and the rest of it. And then they were invaded by the Nazis, by the Germans. And lo and behold, the Germans had exactly what they needed in order to achieve one of their policies. They had this nice database of all these people of Jewish origin, prepared on the basis of a good governance, perhaps, by a liberal state. That's the ultimate fear. I think the public complacency about this stuff is all based on the idea that it's unthinkable that we should have regimes that might want to use that stuff for bad purposes. And, you know, hopefully that's right. Hopefully that's right. But, you know, I do worry about it a bit.
Well, I mean, I don't think it's at all surprising that people take a different view of a power in the hands of the British state as compared the power in the hands of the present Iranian state. I think it's surprising that people should take a different view. But the point you make is nevertheless a useful one, which is that once these capacities are up and running and they're being utilised, it's very difficult to stop them, and it's very difficult to stop them being developed. And I suspect we're going to find that with tempura. I don't see any sign at all that we're about to descend into a totalitarian state in this country. I don't think that's on the horizon. But it's certainly true that once these technologies are in existence, it's very difficult, I would say impossible, to dismantle them.
So let me just draw things together. So it seems like one of the take-homes from the discussion is the complexity of who does the holding to account, and whether they're people who are, in some sense, captured by the security narrative, whether they're able to hold the security experts doing a right and appropriate job, but nevertheless making sure those agencies don't overreach themselves. So I hope you'll join me in thanking our Ken and John for their contributions today.